at home and we have nothing to do. There is no students have disappeared, colleagues have disappeared, everybody has disappeared. So this is a good chance to get back to that life. So that's very important. And number two, I think also this effort itself is very interesting because I have not, frankly, I mean, must confess that I have not attended most of these 95 lectures that has happened before me. But I did attend a few of them. And I was talking with Krishnan about this. And I think at a time when everybody is stuck in home, there's many, many things are happening. Apart from academics, many mental issues are happening. First is, of course, the boredom and how to handle it. But come from that, there are other things about children, you know, women's violence and this and that. I don't want to go into the gory details of that, but the mental health is very important. And so I was very surprised, I mean, very happy to see that such interactions are taking place. So people are participating, learning, and then exchanging ideas by which we can handle this unprecedented situation a little bit nicely. So thank you for welcoming me. I don't want to waste much time because there's only 40 minutes. So I'm going to now start with this lecture. I started the lecture. So let me first qualify one thing before we start, because I have written this as Behavioral Economics 101. So why Behavioral Economics and why 101, I must tell you. So first let me understand, because as I'm an economist, then I have written Behavioral Economics. Normally all the presentation will be on Behavioral Finance. So I have written economics. So I must clarify what is the difference between behavioral economics and behavioral finance. Well, I normally think that behavioral economics is the more general term, because in this field of study, we try to analyze human actions which seem to be really inconsistent with some of the assumptions of that economists make. Of course, I am an economist, but we do make the assumption of a perfect rationality. That means people can really solve seriously high level utility functions with constraints and stuff like that, and then they take a decision. Of course, we understand that I do not want to use the word literate and illiterate, because those are very normative terms, but you know, if you want to solve a problem, you require some mathematical knowledge, and when it comes with maximize u of x subject to 100 constraints, I mean, as a professor, I myself cannot solve those problems. So then to expect that an average person can solve that problem with infinite rationality doesn't seem to be in a really good assumption. So behavioral economics is that part which somehow relaxes this assumption of infinite rationality. And that's why, and then it goes. Now it so happens that in financial markets, this behavior of economic agents is highly observable, because in financial markets, trading is happening at real time. A lot of people are participating and we can see lots of actions. And then we see certain actions which don't seem to be consistent with what our rational expectations or expected utility hypothesis should tell us. And that's why, you know, behavioral economics and behavioral finance is a little bit a part of that, I think. Behavioral finance is a little bit part of behavioral economics, but nevertheless a very important part. So in this presentation, I'm going to talk somehow, switch between these word behavioral economics and behavioral finance. I mean, it's not too much of a difference. Economists are everywhere. Economics simply means that you explain the behavior of agents. So these agents could be in the financial markets, in social sphere, could be in government decisions and other things. So behavioral economics is a general term, and behavioral finance is, of course, a very significant subfield of behavioral economics. So with that, let me start. See, what we observe from, these are the first observations that came in financial markets, that normally in financial markets, we see a lot, Krishna, and I want somebody to give me a bell saying that maybe let us say 20 minutes it left, because if it's like that, yeah, so that I know how far I'm going there. So one very surprising thing of these financial markets is there is a lot of trading that happens, and this trading, a huge volume of trading is happening, and this trading is done not only by institutional investors, but it is also done by individual investors who seem to have very less information. So if you have lots of information about the financial markets, you will trade a lot. But if you have no information, then the best thing is not to trade, because why you are trading at all if you have no information or you cannot process that information. But if we observe, then we see not only trading by institutional investors, but there is also a lot of trading by individuals. So that raises importantly the question of the efficient market hypothesis, which says that moment investors get information, everybody can process this information so quickly that this information will be quickly absorbed into your decisions, and then there'll be no trade because you are in equilibrium now, because you have got information, reacted very quickly, and therefore no trade. So I'll expect that trading should happen like straight line and then shoot up and then immediately adjust and then it will go down. So it will be like a blip will come as more information is coming. However, if you observe in real time and in real world, you don't see that these blips. It's like trading is happening every day at a very, very, very high level. So then it doesn't seem to be very rational because with respect to the rational expectation, rational or efficient market hypothesis, that you, everything got absorbed into the news, and why are you trading at all? I mean, this much, because information is not coming continuously all the time. Maybe in COVID time it is coming, but generally it doesn't come every day. So how do you explain this? So this is how this initial thought started. That, and of course it is now with respect to trading behavior, but there are many things. If you read there, you will see tulip mania and all other notions are there. Basically meaning some actions are happening which doesn't seem to be fitting well with the normal economic assumption of infinite rationality. And that's how the behavioral economics came into part. So now, therefore I say this large amount of trading behavior is not consistent with in the efficient market hypothesis. So behavioral economics therefore was born, or behavioral finance was born as an alternative paradigm. And let me read out this slide because this is important. So behavioral economics came and offered insights and plausible explanations as to why we can expect to see such behavior of like huge amount of trading on part of investors. So here are the main points. The efficient market hypothesis is built on the assumption that investors are fully rational, who quickly update their beliefs following the Bayes rule when they receive new information. And then they maximize expected utility while making their choice on uncertain outcome. This is the expected utility hypothesis. Investors are fully rational. When information comes, they can process everything and then they will act on it, and that's it. And while acting on it, they are going to take help of the expected utility. That means given a lottery, they will say P into U of X1 plus 1 minus P into U of X2. And the two outcomes of the lottery are X1 and X2. So they are able to solve everything. Now, behavioral economics came and challenged both these assumptions. They are saying that these building blocks of the, the challenges both these building blocks of the efficient market hypothesis by arguing that investors often update their belief, which is influenced by various biases. So Bayes rule is there, but their decision using the Bayes rule is getting somehow covered by the fact that they have some biases. So now it is no longer probability into UX, probability which is a function of Bayes rule, which is a statistics, but that probability function is now also subjected to your bias. So probability is a function of the Bayes rule, comma, your own biases. And that will actually change your expected utility or expected valuation of your trading. So second, such updating which departs from the Bayes rule, investors are inconsistent with the expected. I'm being muted by the host or something. You are muted. Okay, not muted, maybe. Second, such adapting, which often departs from the Bayes rule, investors make choices which are inconsistent with the expected utility theory. So they are attacking two things. They are attacking the infinite rationality of the efficient market hypothesis, and they are attacking the expected utility theory. Right? So now, okay, can you not, I want it like this. So I can see the slides. So now both these ideas have their grounding in cognitive psychology. They have their groundings in cognitive psychology. Yeah, I don't want to see that screen coming up. Both these ideas have their groundings in cognitive psychology. Yeah, thank you. Cognitive psychology, which has documented certain traits of human behavior when faced with risky prospects. So now they are bringing in some psychology to say, how will people act? Because they have to bring in some structure into this thinking. Please get that thing down. Now, so therefore they came up with what is called this prospect theory. So what is this prospect theory? So let me first say this prospect theory was proposed by two psychologists, Kahneman and Tversky. You must be always knowing them. You must have read them. As an alternative to the expected utility theory for modeling decision-making under risk, because mostly in the financial markets, people are trading on stocks, and you do not know what will be the price of the stock tomorrow. So there is inherent amount of risk is there. And therefore, so this is how people make a decision under risk. So this prospect theory became an alternative to the expected utility theory for modeling decision under risk. So now what is this expected utility theory? As we know, it has the origin in the works of von Neumann and Morgenstern. It's a normative theory. It's a normative theory of how individual should behave while choosing between risky gambles, assuming their preference satisfy a number of assumptions. So that's a normative theory. In contrast, the prospect theory is a descriptive theory of how individuals actually behave while choosing between risky outcomes, as documented in a large number of experiments in cognitive psychology. So they had done in some experiments and figured out this is how people actually behave. And it is the theory of the, and it is the task of the theory to explain the behavior that you observe. But expected utility theory, of course, wants to have the final goal. But they said people should behave like that. And if you do not behave like that, you are the problem, because you are not behaving according to what I think is correct. But I think it should be reversed. I mean, it is task of the theory to explain how I behave. Of course, I mean, there has to be some structure, because if I behave like a crazy man, I mean, there will be no theory which can describe. But that is the fundamental difference between the expected utility, which is a normative of how you should behave, versus a prospective, prospect theory, which is a descriptive of people actually behave. So at the end of the day, maybe we can collapse and get to the same thing. But this is the two fundamental difference. One is a bottoms-up approach, another top-down approach. So this is the fundamental difference. Yeah, Ekta has entered. Oh my God, which Ekta? So, okay, now I understand that surprise. I cannot figure out who is entering. Okay, now, okay. So now, this all slide is also very important. The prospect theory and the expected theory, four fundamental differences there are. Four fundamental differences, apart from that overarching one. This is now we are trying to model these things, and then therefore we have to go to a structure. So this is the fundamental four fundamental difference. First, prospect theory, while assessing risky gambles, people look not at the final wealth that they can attain, but the gains and losses emanating from such gambles. Let me explain. I mean, this is very important. Suppose I am a poor man. So I have 100 bucks is my income. Now I'm facing a lottery of 10 bucks that will give me one outcome is that I'll get 20 rupees, and in the other one, I'll get minus 10 rupees, right? No. So now I'm a poor person. So I think that I will, in this lottery, I will gain 10 rupees. Let's make it symmetric. 10 rupees I'll gain and I'll lose 10 rupees. So now I think that this is a problem for me, because because I'm a poor person. Therefore, I don't want to take the lottery, because 10 rupees I'll gain. But if I lose another 10 rupees, then it will be big trouble for me, because I'll have 90 rupees. If I'm a rich person, then I'll think, "Arey, let me take the lottery, because if I gain 10 rupees, my profit will increase by 10 rupees. Yeah. But if I lose 10 rupees, then it's not a big problem, because my final wealth, suppose my wealth is 1 million rupees. Then it will be 1 million rupees minus 10 bucks, which is nothing. So let me take a prospect. And therefore, in the expected utility theory, you look at the end result. That means if I had 100, then my outcomes are 90 and 110. You look at the final wealth position. But in prospect theory, what happens is that you look not only, you disregard your initial stages. You disregard your wealth and you look only at that lottery, which means what? That even rich people will going to straight, because they said, "I will at least get 100 rupees. I don't care about the losses. I care about the losses, right?" So therefore, I am not looking at my final wealth. I am looking at my incremental wealth or loss. Likewise, a poor person is not looking at 10 rupees of loss. 90 rupees of final outcome. He is looking only at 10 rupees. So this is one fundamental difference which will increase trading behavior, because some people, even if they are rich, they are not going to say, nothing will be added on my wealth. Of course, because you are not talking about the wealth itself. You are just taking, "I will get 100 rupees. That's all. So this is very important. Second, The gains and losses are measured with respect to a reference point, which could be different for different individuals. So it still allows. That means for me, my reference point is 100. Your reference point is 200. Somebody's reference point is 1,000. So reference point can change. But when you evaluate, you don't look at the final wealth. You look at the incremental wealth. So this will automatically give higher trading behavior. Third, probabilities are replaced by decision weights. I don't want to go in between. I don't want to go into the details of this. So simply means in utility theory, you multiply P into U of X1 plus 1 minus P of U X1. Here you multiply not with P, you multiply with the decision weight D1 of value of X1 plus 1 minus D1. So decision weights a little bit different than probability. Why it is so, I don't want to go get into that because that's not very, it's important, but no. What is more important, and finally, decisions are based on value of gains, not utility of gains. See, value of gains. So this is important. Because in expected utility theory, it's P into U of X1 plus P1 minus P1 U of X2. Right? But in prospect theory, it is D1. D1 is the probability. D1 into not UF, V of X1 plus 1 minus D, V of X2. So the U is changed by V. V is a value function. And the probability is changed by the decision weight. So decision weight, I'll tell you later, but most important is the utility function. Why it is this? So now here is the last line, which is very important. Why this comes up? I don't like this. Sorry. So here, so now what is important is this line, you know, the last line. You can see my cursor moving now. The value function is normally concave for gains and convex for losses, and is generally steeper for losses and losses than for gains. What does it mean? And decision weights are really lower than the corresponding probabilities, except in the range of lower probabilities. So this is what, now here is the picture. Look at this. This, in this graph, this is loss and this is gain. You look at the gains, it is a concave function. And in the losses, it is a convex function, right? So somehow it happens that you are more concerned about large losses than you are concerned about large gains, because it is more convex. So if you have a loss of minus 100, you are likely to have huge loss in value compared to if you had 100 rupees gain. Because people are like that only. They are, by construction, people get more worried than they are happy. So if I gain 100 rupees, then I say, I got 100 rupees. I had 100 rupees. I got 100 rupees, so it became double. But if you lose 100 rupees, then you say, 100 rupees, I lost 100 rupees. Then you should be exactly same amount of sadness, no? But you will not be having same amount of sadness that you had for happiness. You are going to get crazy. So if you have 100 rupees gain, then you say, my value function is U of 100, which is a convex part, a concave part. But if you lose 100, then U of minus 100, V of minus 100 is like much, much greater than V of plus 100, because you feel completely blown out that all my money has gone. Because as individuals, we try to be more worried than we are more happy. We are trained to give less weights to the positive things and give much, much weight to the negative things. Well, I'm talking this about cognitive psychology. You all are listening to my lecture. So you can judge for yourself whether 100 rupees of gains will make you as happy as a loss of 100 rupees. So I mean, if it is same, then your utility function is like the other, the usual one. But if losses make you more worried than gain, equal magnitude of gain, then you are satisfying the value function. And I'm almost sure in the set of the audience listening, at least 85% will satisfy this value function. They'll be more worried about the loss than the gain. And of course, this is the value function. This is the decision weight function. So this is actually the probability and this is the decision weight and this is the 45 degree line. So when the probability is low, you can see the decision weights are higher than the 45 degree line, which means higher. And when the probability goes to one, then the decision weights become lower than the probability. Simply because like this, when the probability of event is a very low, in expected utility theory, you do not give him that much weight. It disappears. 0.001. 0.001, when you multiply with ux of 1, it will disappear because the probability is so less. But in prospect theory, at when probability is 0.001, your decision weight is not 0.001. Your decision weight is likely to be 0.01, 10 times higher. Why? That means you tend to not ignore these plane events. So that day I was talking to one of my students, and then he said that, you know, when we think in a very irrational way, we think like if I go in an aircraft, then I will meet with the accidents, right? And then if I meet with the accident, then I die. And then my loss is infinity, right? My loss is infinity. So what is my expected gain of flying? Probability of safe flight is P. And then if I go there, then I go to Los Angeles, Disneyland, I have fun. So that's P of U of X1. And the loss is 1 minus P of UX2, which is my E-plane, God forbid, has happened something. That probability is almost 0.0000001, correct? No. Then if you multiply with a loss, then this will disappear. But people do not think like that. People think of one thing. They will sometimes disregard the probability. They will think 0.0001 multiplied by an infinity epsilon because you are losing everything. So then you become focused on the probability itself. Then you think, "Are this is well again, this loss is so much, then even if the probability is very low, I am going to disregard this probability and give a higher decision weight on that because I think, well, it is a possible outcome. And then generally my decision weight will be higher than my, probability outcome." So this is what, this is the picture. So now, this is how it goes. So what is happening? Yeah. So this is also very important. So the asymmetric impact of gains and losses, the shape and the curvature of the value function under the prospect theory implies that people will be risk averse when choosing between gains and risk seeking when choosing between losses. Risk seeking means you are going to seek risk when you are at loss, but you will become risk averse, which is the normal expected utility function when you are gains. Why? The fact that the value function is steeper for losses than for gains implied that equal magnitude of gains and losses have asymmetric impacts on the decision. Losses hurt much more than gains give pleasure. This is very important. Losses hurt more than gains give pleasure. Finally, the fact that the value function is derived from based on gains and losses. This is also very important. Gains and losses rather than on the final 12 position implies that investors will tend to view each gamble separately in a collection of gambles and end up in making choices which might seem inconsistent in the aggregate. This is very important because in expected utility theory, everything is depending on your final wealth. So every time that there are three gambles, you find what will be my final wealth? What will be my final wealth? So it's a cumulative one. But in prospect theory, they are saying you look at gains and losses. You look at each lottery separately. So then, and make a decision about each lottery. Action one, lottery one, I take an action. Action two, lottery, I take an action. Action three, I take an action. Then when I put all the actions together, then I find, oh my God, I have taken a wrong decision. Because when you took a decision, you are looking only at one part. You are not looking at the whole. And people always do like that. I think there must be psychologists sitting here. People generally say, whatever has happened. Now let me look at this new thing. Let me eat this. Let me go there. So we think like that rather than accumulating everything, which is a more rational way of doing. So don't get me wrong, that expected utility theory is supposed to be a normative theory, but it still tells you in a normative way how people should react. Now, if you try to explain everything based on your act, then I might have to force to model some irrational thing. So I'll come back to that. But this is what happened. You look at each action separately so that when I put all the actions together, it seems is a wrong decision. In expected utility theory, it will never happen. Why? Because you always look at the final wealth and do it. So therefore, it gets subsumed into your utility function all the time. So now let me go to the financial markets and try to tell you exactly what are this type of now human biases. Now, it's a very nice thing that when I'll come to that, when human biases are infinite. I mean, I have lots of biases, right? So of course my biases are only my biases. So what people have done is to document some biases which happens to me, Krishnan and Dr. Meeta Jha. So I just took your name because I can see your name there. So it happens to many, many people. So this is what people have figured out. So never. So while the prospect theory provides an analytical framework for understanding those behaviors of individuals that systematically deviate from the presumption of expected utility hypothesis, there are behaviors of investors that are driven by biases which do not yield themselves to easy modeling. Like when I draw the value function, I could draw something. But here biases, how they change the value function, I is very difficult for me to model. So now it becomes more empirical, you know, because I cannot put them into theory that this bias will change the value function like this, this bias will change the value function like this. I cannot say. So the prospect theory gives you a structure of an analytical framework. After that, there comes bias, which are mostly empirical. So nevertheless, we cannot influence, we cannot, you know, ignore these biases because human behavior seems to be in conformation with these biases. So I'll tell you about four biases and then I'm going to tell you something more. So these biases are overconfidence, confirmatory bias, conservatism, and representative heuristics. So what are these things? So psychologists have convincingly demonstrated that people are often overconfident in their judgments. I am right. I am the supreme leader. I will take this decision. This will happen. Overconfident in their judgments, which make them underestimate the risk of certain outcomes. So you are overconfident, then you, therefore you risky outcomes do not appear risky to you. You take a decision. Overconfidence comes partly from confirmatory bias, where individuals tend to look for characteristics in a risky outcome that conforms to one's own existing beliefs. So one situation has arisen. It has good things and bad things. You have decided, you have thought that this is how it should look. Then what happens while looking at it, you try to look at only the things that conforms to your expectation. So you disregard the other one because you don't want to prove yourself wrong. So, and human beings always do that. That is called confirmatory bias. Then, very closely related to this confirmatory bias is almost an opposite bias, which is said conservatism. I think stock market, this price is going to increase. Now, when bad things happen, director has resigned, independent director has gone away. Since you thought that, you know, you want to confirm your bias, then you become conservatism. You try to ignore these facts. Why? So you become you become conservative in the sense that you don't want to see all other information because you don't want to change your belief. So that is conservatism, which is also the counterpart of confirmatory. Because if I disregard bias, if I'm very conservative, then I will never ever change myself, which will in turn means that all the time my things will be confirmed because I'm just looking for them. So in some sense, very important here is the what is called overconfidence is represented by heuristics. What is this heuristics? Heuristics means this one. That means, so representative heuristics, tendency of people to judge the probability of an uncertain outcome by looking at present patterns present in the sample without paying sufficient attention to the probability of the pattern. So you got a sample. In the sample, you find many good things are happening. Therefore, you say, oh, in the world is good. But you have to recognize the fact that you have a sample and maybe this sample is not a random sample, for example. Then this sample, even if it is a random sample, it is still a sample. So therefore, you should not only make your decision conditional on the sample, but you must find out the probability of having that sample. But people, they tend to forget that it's a sample. They look at the pattern in the sample, then project it with the population, without worrying too much about the fact that whether the sample has a probability or not. So given these ones, so this prospect theory started with all this. This is a basis. Then it came into some biases and they talk about these biases. So now when they talk about these biases, this is only a normative thing only. That biases is there, but how do I prove that the biases are there or not? So I might have some biases. I may have lots of biases, but in my trading behavior, these biases never show up. So how do I figure out that my biases is actually influencing my decisions? I might have lots of bias. I have a bias against anybody, But in my action, if I do not do anything, then you cannot tell me that your bias is bad or good. I mean, to begin with, how will you ever even to find out my biases? So that is not possible, right? So this is what I write here now. So prospect theory now meets empirics. The prospect theory is now, hey, prospect theory, mamam, welcome Sumedha Sarkar. My daughter has joined this webinar. Good evening. Thank you very much for joining this. Okay. She's a lawyer, so maybe I don't know. She's a psychologist also, maybe. So prospect theory meets empirics. So now you have told about some biases, but whether the biases are simply actually influencing my behavior, you have to find it out. And the way that you can find it out is by looking at observed actions. If you look at the actions, and the actions are not in conformity with what I expect you to observe, as per expected utility theory or infinite rationality, then I must conclude that there must be some other thing that causing your actions to deviate from what is expected. And that is what is that behavioral economics. So here you go. So how do prospect theory and the documented bias help in explaining trading behavior of individual, which seems otherwise inconsistent with expected utility hypothesis? So empirical studies that analyze trading behavior based on micro-level databases containing trading records of large number of investors in a wide variety of stocks, because it cannot be small samples, because then the outcome will be based on the sample only. So these empirical studies in behavioral finance normally have millions and millions of observations from millions and millions of people. So that if you get a result, you cannot say this crazy result is coming because you have taken only Chotu sample. Then, because you have millions of people and millions of stocks over millions of days, I mean trading seconds, let us say, then the empirical observation is the depiction of reality by statistics, simple by statistics. So the first observation is that excessive trading behavior, as noted earlier, the efficient market hypothesis would tend to predict very little trading to happen, which seems inconsistent with observed facts. However, overconfidence provides an immediate explanation of such excessive trading behavior, as investors tend to overestimate their ability of forecasting uncertain events and trade much more than they warrant. Basically saying that every individual becomes a trading house. I mean, they think that they know everything, they can understand the theory itself. They are not understanding anything, but they are still going and trading because they have overconfidence that, you know, I did right. And they do it, but you know, we are overconfident. They think they know everything. You must have heard that, you know, this theory of Dunning-Kruger effect. Dunning-Kruger effect means what? Like people who, I'm not directing with it to anybody, but this is a behavioral thing. Because the Dunning-Kruger effect is documented psychological effect. That means if you know less, you take more action. You speak a lot. If you know a lot more, then you become conservative. You don't want to give too much of advice because you know the advice that I am giving may be wrong. But if you are not ignorant to begin with, then whatever you know, you said, do this, do that, do these 100 things, because you do not know anything. So if you have overconfidence and less knowledge, that might actually lead you to do much more in a society than compared to other society where actions can be less because they're only educated people. So they are thinking of their actions and they're taking slowly, they're taking actions. But in a society where there are lots of overconfident people, they might take quick actions thinking that, you know, I know everything, which is not the case. I mean, so therefore the Dunning-Kruger effect is a document of economic behavior of behavior of agents. You might read that, the Dunning-Kruger effect. Now, so I want to run through this slide very quickly because you will understand that. So these are empirical studies. Now we are going to empirical studies. So one, that trades are driven by overconfidence rather by irrational motives coming from the fact that investors lose their money. That is where the bias is coming, because you see a lot of trading is happening and the investor is losing money. That means you are overconfident. That means you took a bad decision. So let us see this. I just want to study. I want to give you some 2-3 examples. So in one study, Nicholas Barber, I mean, he's very well known, who examined the trading activity in Taiwan from 1995-99 using the complete transaction record of Taiwan exchange. So he is not taking She's not taking one investor. He's taking the complete transaction record of Taiwan Exchange, every action that has happened. And then they find that the aggregate portfolio of individuals suffers an annual performance penalty of 3.8 percentage points, which amounts in aggregate to 2.8 percentage points of their entire personal income. So they find they are trading so much, they are losing 3%, about 3% of their loss. So it has to be overconfident. Of course, it could be ignorance also. But you are taking an action, right? So whether what is driving you, I do not know. It may be ignorance. But it may be ignorance or it may be overconfidence. But nevertheless, you are not acting in a rational way. Then there are many other things that, so I don't want to go into all of these things. But you shall observe the following thing. What it basically these studies are saying. They are taking a large sample, almost the population of trading people, and they are finding the following thing. They are using lots of trading and they are losing money on the trading. And I particularly like Shumedha for you. I like this last part where they say, please, I'm reading it out. So please, all who are gender equal to F means female, they will like this one. In a subsequent paper, Barber and Odin, using the same data set and exploiting the evidence that men are most likely to be overconfident than women in areas such as finance, show that men on an average trade 45% more than women, which reduces their net return by 2.6 percentage point here compared to 1.72 percentage. So they find this is, and their data set has the gender. They separate the men and women, they find both of them overtrade. So it is not that women are not trading. Women are also trading. So they are also overconfident. But the men are more overconfident. So what do you call is man speaking or something like that. They try to explain everything. Mansplaining or something like that. And you know the title of the paper is what? At the end of the day, I'm going to give you the title of all the behavioral economics paper. And you will say, the title itself is so nice. But I mean, you will love reading it. So the title of this paper is Boys Will Be Boys. The title of this paper is Boys Will Be Boys. So boys are crazy guys. I mean, crazy gender. So they do something. So beautiful, beautiful article. So this article is called Boys Will Be Boys. So now I don't want to read the whole slide, but I will tell this is a disposition effect is a very important effect in behavioral finance. What it says that faced with 100 rupees gain, suppose you bought a stock at 100 rupees and the stock is now 150. So you are gaining 50 rupees. You will immediately run and sell the stock. Yeah, because you'll get 50 rupees gain. Now, suppose the stock is 100 and the stock price becomes 50, then you are going to lose minus 50, right? So you should now sell it. If it is symmetric behavior, then you should sell it. But they observe the following. When there is loss, people don't sell of the same amount. So if they like 20 people have 100 rupees, 50 rupees gain, 15 people will sell it. But when there is loss of 50 rupees, out of 20 people, only 3 people will sell it. 18 people will not sell. Why? Because there's a reluctance to sell. And this is a nice line, which I like very much. So I'm going to read here. Please read the last two lines. This tendency of investors to postpone the realization of their losses is aptly summarized by Barber et al. In 2009, who observed that investors who buy and sell individual securities have little or no ability to distinguish between future winners and losses. So you cannot distinguish who will win, that whether stock will rise or stock will fall, because it is not beyond your competence, because you do not know. However, they do, however, have the ability to...
What I see is fiction.
Hello. So they do, however, have the ability to put off the day of reckoning. The typical and the aggregate investor postpones selling, losing in increments because like they, like the rest of us, hate to admit their mistakes. Because when you are having a loss, then it's a mistake that I bought a bad stock. And you don't want to acknowledge these mistakes that you have committed. Because if you don't sell the stock, then the loss is not realized, right? So you hold on the stock. So it becomes from 100 to 90, you don't sell. 80, you don't sell. 70, you don't sell. 60, you don't sell. Because if you now sell, then people will say, what stupid investment you have made. Then you don't sell. Then it becomes 40, 30. At the end of the day, you just run away. You don't sell the stock. Then you at the end, you say, I didn't have the stock to begin with. The question is, of selling is not there. You hide it. So this is called disposition effect, which is highly, highly documented in the literature. Krishna, how much time? Yes. 2 minutes. I told you to give me, you unmute yourself. I said, you should give, tell me 20 minutes before. You are now telling me I have only 2 minutes. Okay, I'm almost done. No, I don't need 2 minutes. You have to give me 10 minutes. Then I will stop. Then we can have the discussion. So now, I'm not going to tell you all about these biases. What I'm going to do is that, why is that thing not going down? Yeah, I have given you the link to a website. This is a beautiful website on behavioral economics. If you click that link, it will take you to the website of the behavioral economics, and there all sort of documentary biases are there. Sort of biases are all written and you can read. And the nice thing or a nice significant observation to think it, as the time is going over and over, the number of biases are increasing and increasing and increasing. So people are finding out, people are finding more and more biases. So, you know, so the website keeps on expanding. And that is, of course, a particular challenge for the prospect theory. Why? Because, of course, another thing I wanted to say, some challenges. This is important. Because some people say behavioral economics is a very easy theory, because everything that you try to, you cannot explain, you bring another bias. I cannot explain his behavior. Finally, you say he's a crazy man. That's another bias. That way, you can explain everything, right? So therefore, theory should be falsifiable. If you say this is a theory, I should be able to falsify it. But every time you run, you bring a counter observation, then you do not call it counter observation. You are basically telling that this is a bias. So that is no good. And this is something you have to figure it out. So now I'm going to quickly run through it. So emerging economies, economies like India, Brazil and other ones are very good laboratory of doing this financial research on behavioral finance, because most of the work has been done in developed countries simply because exchanges just do not give you the data. But I must tell you one thing, which is very important. SEBI has a policy nowadays. SEBI has a policy. This is important. This has nothing to do with the talk. The Securities Exchange Board of India now has an official policy of sharing their data, any data, provided you give your proposal for them. Right, I am in that committee. I mean, we are supposed to publicize this. That's why I'm telling you. If you go to SEBI website, you will find data sharing policy. You can ask for this trading behavior data. They will give it to you. I mean, after some clearance and things like that. So now, I don't want to run this slide. I'm going to stop. This is the stock market activity which you have just picked up from the NSE ownership tracker. But I wanted to tell you this. Look at this ownership tracker. You see, this is the trading behavior of the domestic mutual fund. This is the financial institution. These are individuals. Do you see the graphs are completely different? One is rising, one is stable, one is falling. So people are actually trading. If everybody was rational, then everybody must be trading in the same way, right? But they are not rational in that sense. So therefore, during COVID times, lots of things are happening on the stock market. We are not paying that much of attention. But this graph is enough to say that a lot of activities are happening and people are behaving in very, very different ways, right? And finally, so I've just given you some graph. Now, these are some references which I have given to you. So you can read these references if you want to read. And finally, these are the papers that I have given. I have the PDF, all the paper. I can send it to Krishnan. Otherwise, you can simply Google and find out. And you shall see the nice papers are very nice, nice names are there. All the nice, nice, nice names are there. So you can read all these papers. You simply Google and find them. And that's it. So thank you for listening. And I am happy to take questions now.
Thank you so much, sir, for that enlightening session. It's a rare on behavioral economics and a very new topic for us as well. Thank you so much, And now the floor is open for question and answers. The first question is from Subhashree, ma'am. Ma'am, can you unmute yourself?
Krishnan, 1 minute. Krishnan, can I now get to stop share thing? Can I do a stop share and then I can get back the screen? Yeah, okay. Oh, yeah, my sure. God. Oh, it's such nice to see so many people. I will take a photograph. Please don't mind.
Please.
Favorite hobby to take photographs. So please give me 1 second time. Okay, here you go. Oh, my God.
Sumedha, I am seeing your father like this for 35 years, like this.
Oh, I can see my wife also. Oh, my God. I mean, everybody's there. Yeah, now shoot the question. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Thank you.
First of all, that was fantastic session, and it was an enlightening one because it's a rare topic for all of us psychologists sitting over here. Yeah. And the very important aspect of now being in this pandemic period, we all are hit, and it is going to be being in India, being in developing country also, it's going to be a very great setback in economic scenario. In that case, what could be your suggestion for a financial resilience? And for what kind of sector will be affected more, and what could be done from psychologist and as well as an economist perspective? You have to unmute yourself. I mean, mute is there in the...
Unmuted, is it? Oh,
yeah, please.
Well, as an economist, I'll give an answer, but I mean, it's for the government to spell out exactly what they are going to do. They have given financial package of 20 lakh crores, so you can find out from there. You can read the 20 lakh crores ka financial package and figure out exactly what they're trying to do. But let me tell you something, because since you have asked me a question, I should give an answer. I think the first thing that the government should, not government, anybody should do, is that this is not the time to decide whose sector is going to, which sector should open first, which sector should open second, which sector should open third. This is not the question to ask. This is not the time to ask this question. The question is to increase demand. You have to just go and give money in the hands of the people. If you give the money to the hands of the people, farmers, middle class, I mean, lower middle class, reduced tax rate, everybody gets the money. If everybody gets the money, then we are in a severe, severe downturn. I mean, we are going to grow at like 1.5% to 2.5% in this year. Next year, we are predicted to go at negative rates. Grow at negative rates sounds very nice. Oh, we are still growing. Growing at negative rates basically means we are falling down, right? But you say we are growing at a negative rate. Don't use that. We are growing at a negative rate. It makes no sense. You should say we'll contract. Do not say growing at a negative rate. It makes it diverts your attention. So we are supposed to grow at minus rates in the first quarter of, in this coming quarter. So there is no way of opening sectors, this sector, that sector. I mean, you have absolutely no idea. If you tell me in one logical way, I look at the input-output table and I'll figure out which industry follow in whatever. Because that day I was looking at some guys who are saying they have opened up the one ancillary industry who are making auto parts. They have opened up that industry. Right. However, they are saying, what is the big point of opening up my bolts and nuts and screws if you are not making the car itself? Because whom do I supply? So therefore, then you have to decide. Okay, I'll open the car one. Then you will say, if I open the car, then the car guys will say, I need tire. I have to open the rubber industry. Then the rubber guy will say, I need this one. Then somebody will say, I need steel. So that way you cannot do. You can look at an input-output table, but in a typical input-output table, every industry is connected. So you cannot make this decision. What you can do is the following. You give the money in the hand of the people. Their demand will come. And when the demand comes, people will respond. I mean, especially at this point of time where we are going through we have been going through this time for the last 3-4 years, but nobody wants to admit that. But now there is no question of hiding behind anything. So you have to give money directly to the hand of the people. And that's my answer. You have to increase my demand and not worry about which sector. But you have a question. Which sector is likely to be the most affected? Obviously, farmer. Obviously, the unskilled laborers. I am still look at my shirt. I am sitting here and we are all listening to it. Nothing has happened to us. But see what has happened to the farmer, what has happened to the laborer. We are all listening. Nice behavioral economics 101. We are actually learning. We are having all positive effect. And we are eating good food in our house. So there is no opening. Give money to everybody.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Krishnan, sir.
Shubhanta, I just want to know where this specialization of behavior economics could be done, at what level? And another one is, what's the scope for the field? Which are the sectors one can look at it for a job when people do their economics or psychology, where they can look at it as a specialization and get a job?
You are asking that where is behavioral economics is like behavioral economics and which are the areas where it is applied, and then whether this knowledge can be
utilized.
Yeah, somebody's mic is on. Yeah, okay. So the best answer is that why you just change the topic of the lecture that I have given today from behavioral economics to behavioral finance, and the whole financial industry is waiting for you. So you please read the references that I have given on Nicholas Barbaris as to what is, so they call it behavioral economics to make it a little bit broad, but actually they are behavioral finance, like how people trade, how people do these things. So you just study any student or any faculty or whoever wants to, I mean, students who want to job and things like that. They just read it and they read all the papers that, I have given reference to. Yeah, published paper. I just master it by heart and go to a Citibank or go to anybody and say, I am the big person who knows all behavioral economics. They will take you a 20 lakh salary. And if you are able to bargain properly, you might give even half a crore.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great, sir. Yeah.
Everybody. Oh, of course, no, I should not say everything should not be finance. But, if you understand that, if you go from behavioral economics to behavioral finance to behavioral economics, then you can actually apply to NBER and all other places, because people do not seem to take behavior. It is not right to say people do not act in the way they are supposed to. That is wrong. That is putting the theory before the human being. The human being should be the first, and theory should come later. Job of the theory is to explain the human. It is not the job of the human to act according to the theory. So you should go to all these other NBA sort of think tanks and other JPL and all these institutes, which try to understand human behavior. There itself, there is a lot of job. I mean,
job.
They may not be paying you lots of money like that. Yeah, everybody's mic use. Maybe the organizer can unmute all of them.
Veena, just check, ma. Veena. Yeah.
Can I
ask,
sir, all of them are muted. Question? It's just they're unmuting themselves again and again. So I'm handling that.
Okay. Yeah, Shubhrut.
Yeah, so I'm saying that, of course, in finance field, this is the minefield for finance. So everybody is trading in the behavior and making lots of money. And many people are making lots of money right now as we are not looking at the real economy. So, I mean, a limit in terms of earning money and all those things is limitless. Right. So there is the finance. But you should also read all these things, because I mean, earning money is important, but we should also help society. So this will be also real useful to understand human behavior, and join a think tank like a NBER, NCAR, that type of organization. Yes.
Absolutely.
I mean, a huge possibility. Anybody wants to learn, and I'll be happy to give them some reference and whatever not. I mean, there's lots of behavioral economics going on everywhere.
Thank you. Thank you so very much.
Yeah.
Thank you, Subrata, sir. Next question is from Arvind Chandrasekhar,
sir.
Sir, can you unmute yourself and ask the question?
Arvind, sir. Good evening, sir. This is first-year student from Madras School of Economics. Taking a sabbatical after working as a design researcher for 12 years.
Okay.
So one of my biggest cultural shocks, so to speak, studying economics as a proper course, is that economists seem to be in love with jargon.
Yeah.
And they don't seem to, the hard sciences, which over the course of years have made themselves more open to the general public and try to explain their concepts in layman terms, economists seem to be safeguarding their forte per se. Given the fact of information and, you know, the fact that even that you mentioned that SEBI is also taking the call of sharing information, economists don't really seem to, you know, pay much attention to cross-disciplinary or interdisciplinary studies. I mean...
I have lots to say about that. Yeah, is your question over now?
Yeah, so my question is, A, given the fact that efficient market hypothesis, which pharma, you know, proposed whenever... has now been, you know, accepted that it no longer applies. And there is enough traction that Andrew Liu's, you know, adaptive market hypothesis, which is largely empirical, you know, has gained acceptance. But because it's empirical and it's not really, you know, can't be really put to test, it's primarily because economists have not really paid attention to how the consumer consumes, you know, information and the attention economics, which psychologists have over the recent years paid a lot of attention, especially in terms of, you know, attention spans, reducing attention spans for teenagers and so on and so forth. But economists have not really done that much work when it comes to information consumption and resultant behaviors. I mean, a lot of behavioral finance is a function of information, as in how much of information you have. The more information you have, which is where the pharma's efficient thing of, you know, piranhas coming and taking the whole bite comes into play. So my entire question is split into two parts. One is, A, why haven't economists really put in the effort to redefine a utility as a function of information? And two is why the safeguarding of information and not really opening up to interdisciplinary studies.
Okay, can I answer now? You have asked asked a lot of questions and you have beaten up the economists, but since I'm an economist, I have to defend it. Okay,
I'm a student, sir. So
no, that's okay. I mean, you can be student. I mean, we are talking about ideas. At an ideal level, there is no student or professor. I mean, I encourage my students to ask, tell the professor that whatever you are asking makes no sense. I mean, I know that when you are teaching at USC, there one student told Cheng Xia or that ignomination, whatever you have proved is completely wrong. So of course, he later turned out to be right, but he did have the guts to ask him that question. So you should always ask the question like that. I mean, there's no student in a question. Number one. Okay, you know, on a more lighter note, like economists use jargons. I mean, you please go to the marketing guys and ask what jargon they use. So then you will figure out who uses more jargon. Ask the psychologists, ask the lawyers and everything. Ask Sumedha, who is a lawyer. They will use 2,000 jargons. So jargon is a way to advertise yourself. So everybody uses jargon. In sociology, everybody uses jargon. So jargon is not the issue. I mean, everybody uses jargon to just bring yourself. The government uses jargons. Atma Nirbhar Bano is a jargon, right? So I mean, that you do it like that. Number one. Number two. Why it is always the case that economists has to always go and do interdisciplinary? So why should B do A? I mean, interdisciplinary means A and B works together. Now it seems to be that people have realized that A is the Brahmin, so therefore A does not work with B. So and therefore they have themselves said economists are like they don't want to interdisciplinary. B can come to A. Why will the sociologist not come to the economist? Why the economist has to leave his administrative block and go to administrative block C and say, hey, I want to do work with you. I mean, of course, I may not be doing that. That's it. But it could be entirely my responsibility to walk to your house and say, I want to do work with you. You can come to me also. As any economist said that, if Krishnan tells me, I want to work on psychology and economics. He asked me to give this lecture. I saw this is mental health. It has nothing to do with mental health. I do not know myself. My mental health is very bad. But I said, I will give the lecture. So if I said no, I will not give the lecture. Then economist doesn't work to work with sociologists. But it always seems that everybody tends to think that economist does not want to work. I don't think that is correct. So maybe you guys think that economists do some high funda thing, so I don't want to work with them because they must come and tell me. So I do not know. You please come and we are open to working. I mean, we don't have to make a general statement as to economist doesn't want to work. I'll be very happy to work with anyone. I do not know about other economists, but I know lots of economists They all are waiting for, they always say interdisciplinary. It is, I think, honestly speaking, it is the sociologists and all the other people who don't want to economics because they think it is so formal. They will run regression. They will say vector autoregression. I have nothing to do. I will dig up some soil and then I will make a statement. The economist says, why you make this statement? He says, no theoretical basis. So then they don't work together. So that probably is the reason that, you know, both sides have to be open to thoughts. It's not that nobody wants to work anybody. Number three, the final question that you asked, that are economists not learning for something? Yeah, there are some models that they have been developed because please understand, if you want to predict, then you must be having a model, because if you do not have a model, there is no way to predict the future. Because all the data you have is point T. You want to predict something in T plus one. So therefore, there has to be a structure of prediction. That structure comes from a theoretical model. Therefore, a model has to be built. Now, model does not mean equation, but an analytical structure. Economists are much better in doing that. Sociologists are also good. So this is only the reason probably economists build model. Now, is it true that they are not learning? So one thing you have to understand, to build a model, we have to have some rationality built on it. Because it is impossible to, if you justify everybody's action by biases, by sociology, by psychology, by this and that, then so there is no behavior, there is nothing to predict. I mean, I will do something like that. Veena is going to react in some way. Sangeeta is going to react in some way. Oh, is that Sangeeta my student? Yeah. Oh my God. I didn't see, I'm seeing the name, but I cannot figure that out. Then everybody is reacting in their own way. So that is no way of predicting. I do not know what the crazy man I am going to do. So you need a structure. So therefore, economists have been building the model. But the next question is that, are they taking into account of information? Now, by construction, I have given a lecture on behavioral economics. So Nicholas, Barber, Terry, Odin, they are economists only. They are already taking all these things into account. So there is empirical proof that economics is taking into the, it is called behavioral economics, which is going outside the paradigm of this, no? But of course, people who have developed this efficient hypothesis paradigm for hundreds of years, they are not going to say, I am a crazy man, all my theory is wrong. So they are going to defend their turf. But economists are taking. Now, as to information, huge amount of work is happening in the artificial intelligence and the machine learning literature. If you read the work by Hal Varian, Sendil Mulayanathan, and all other people who are working in the AI-ML space, Joshua Grant, NBER papers, these are all economists. I don't want to make a big deal that there's an economist. I'm just putting a label that he's a PhD in economics. So that is an economist, I mean, definitionally. So they are all work. They are taking into account information and all these types of things. You know, what happens is probably economists are not regarded as very good because they say, he predicted the economy will be good. Now the economy is bad. So therefore, that economist must have done a stupid model and said this has happened, that this has not happened. But please understand, you know, for example, I not take this particular government. Look at the United States. They have the best of economists in the whole world. But look at the policies that they have been executed by the executive. It makes no sense. Look at some of the policies executed in India. Thousands of economists are writing saying that please encourage your demand side, not the supply side. Then nobody is listening. Whether this is because of politics or lack of understanding, I do not know. So just to say that the economists are not taking or do not know or are not taking information into account is not correct. I mean, I don't want to be belligerent. I'm just telling is the fact. So it is not that the economists take a decision and that decision is implemented. Please make Kaushik Basu as the Prime Minister of India. I do not quote on me. And other people and make a cabinet of full of economists, right? Full of economists cabinet and empower them to take a decision and to execute that decision. Then you see what will happen. But the economists are taking decision. Nobody is listening. If they are listening, they are not executing. So it is not the entire burden is not on the shoulder of the economists to do that. Everybody has to do. Lawyers have to challenge the governments to say what policies that they are taking. Social activities, sociology should challenge. All NGOs should challenge. But that is not happening. Why is the burden of only economics? It is not burden of economics. Economics are open all through. They are not Brahmins. You have only made them Brahmins.
Thank you, sir. We are glad to know that. The next question is from Suchitra Raj. Suchitra Raj, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question? Suchitra Raj? Okay. Then we have the next question from Ekta.
Hello. Hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
Like my question is now, see, because of this corona, there are a lot of jobs that are going to be like a lot of employees, they are going to be out of job. That's already been declared also. And these people will be actually approaching us for counseling for the mental stress and all these kinds of what to come out of the situation. However, what could be the answer from you, sir, like to support these people who have been out of jobs as a psychologist, what could we support them? How could
It's a very, very important problem. You see, now over the time, over these you know, last 2-3 months, you have observed about two things. Let me first divide this question into two parts. One is, because unfortunately, me as a laborer, because I'm also a laborer, I'm a professor, I work. So in that sense, I labor. So I'm a laborer. Everybody in this webinar is a laborer. So unfortunately, you as a laborer is very different than a laborer who has left Noida and worked home to Bihar. So he is also a laborer. Unfortunately, we call them migrant. I'm a migrant also. I'm from West Bengal. I'm sitting here. Nobody's calling me migrant, right?
Okay.
I'm actually a migrant. So now there are two types of people, labor supply. Now, as far as the skilled labor supply, like us who are reading at this point, I don't think it's actually a problem, because my students keep on asking me what will happen to my job. Now, because we are going through a bad phase. So coming financial year, there may be a little bit loss of employment, even for skilled laborers. But skilled laborers are paid in terms of performance bonuses and things like that. If you look at typical salary, the salary will be 8 lakhs, but performance bonus will be 20 lakhs. That's how their industry has structured. So they'll simply cut off your performance bonus because company is not making any profit. So your salary will go down to from 20 lakhs, will go down to 10 lakhs because they have smartly done your please mute everybody and only unmute one person. So that will be a problem, but they will not lose their employment. They might lose their little bit of income, but they can manage because, I mean, they can at least eat and stuff like that. Your durable goods industry will not be going far. So I think the durable goods industry will recover very slowly, but the consumer goods are fine. But as to your labor question, I don't think people like you or students have another problem. I think students who are in the financial sector actually will be better, because now we are fixing online and all these things. All the service sector is going to increase, and therefore I think it's working in the financial sector, which most of many students do because they are in the service industry, banks and all the stuff, they will not be bad. Now come to the other people, which is the laborers. Laborers, let us call that laborers, because I'm also a laborer. Laborers are the lower skill in the sense they have less education and they're using most of their physical skill. It's a huge, huge problem. In this huge problem, there would be mental health is of course very important, because, but you know, in terms of mental health, how many webinars are these people are listening to this webinar in terms of the migrant labor? They're not listening to them. So you have to first focus as to whom you want to think as your psychologist or, you know, medical advice that you want to give or whatever advice. You have to only figure out whom. So I think it would be people who are educated and have a job but are losing a job. Because, for example, I tell, you know, some students call me and said, sir, we have lost our internship because other students are doing and mine is not doing. So I'm trying to help them by saying that, you know, you should do this and that. So I think you should have to now focus as to whom you want to do. Because first is focusing on laborer at the lower level does not, it is a too humongous a problem for you to handle in terms of mental health. I mean, how can you handle so many people? But in terms of this job, so reach out to the educational institutions and all those people where students are worried about job or just lost a job, and students can connect you to alumni or something like that. So they know exactly that connection world. So you have to define your effort towards the lower level of the educated people, because that is the effective group you can reach. For the other laborers, you alone cannot do. The society has to now spring in. Society has to go in gram panchayat, village panchayat, and all other things. As a social organization, maybe you should supply food. You should do counseling. Counseling in the sense that you should go, everybody should take up a small, small geographical area. Why not all the people who have all come on this webinar screen? Then if they are in villages or some chotu jaga, like you know, Sumedha is in Trichy or maybe around the villages, they can do, they can hold one sort of a, you know, they don't call it webinar, then you will say, you know, come and, you know, come and have a relaxing evening or something, something positive. And then each of us have to do, if you really want to get to the lower level, for them, this webinar thing is not going to work. But we can do lots of things. We can do lots of things in terms of social activity, keeping them, but television would be not be, I mean, mobile or something would not be the way that they would like to do, because they have no time for all these things when you are not getting any food to eat. So you have to handle them separately and you have to handle the lower level of the educational stuff in a different way. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Ekta, not the core member, the other Ekta. Ekta, can you please unmute yourself and ask the question?
Yeah, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Thank you, Krishnan, for sending this link. And thank you, sir. It is always a delight to listen to you. So I have, and also thank you to clarifying on the question of my student, Arvind. So it is always the class starts with motivating him to study economics, especially finance. So I'll keep a close watch on you, Arvind. So on what you have learned. Now, coming to the question. Now, as a teacher, I would like to ask at what level we should teach behavioral economics, and secondly, as a compulsory course. Why we don't see that course being taught so much in the colleges, even at the higher education? Like in MSc, we have it as the last semester course as an elective. So, but I feel that it should be taught as a compulsory course. And because the moment we stop as expected utility, we should teach that. What is your thought on these this question? And the second question is, what is stopping us to promote the research on behavioral finance? Like, why we don't have places like NBR and RAND where the behavioral economics or behavioral finance research is taking place, and kind of, you know, why we don't have SEBI, NSE doing all these things? So these are my two questions.
Okay, so let me, very, very, very important, very thought-provoking question. Let me answer the first one. Why are we not teaching it in educational institutions? I can only guess this is the following, because this is also a question of overall economics, because that brings back to your question of your student. He was not completely incorrect. You know, whether economists really think them as Brahmins. They, some of the economists do think of them as really Brahmins. I mean, I'm not one of them. I'm not a Brahmin. This theory has been developed from long, long years, right? Long years, the efficient market utility hypothesis, because that's a theory in the sense that is a falsifiable theory. The behavioral economics is not a falsifiable theory, because every time you come down, out to the conclusion which is inconsistent with the behavioral economics guys are going to say, oh, this is another bias. So that way, they're always right. So therefore, this theory is not falsifiable. If a theory is not falsifiable, then it's not a theory itself. So therefore, behavioral economics have not gained so much of traction in the usual thought of economics literature. But then, the behavioral economics has said, damn with you. I don't want you any theory. I'm just going to use the behavioral economics because that's how people work. So I don't care what theory you are doing. I don't have my prediction. My idea is not to build theory. My idea is to predict human behavior. So long as I do this. So this is the AI ML sort of an approach. If I can explain behavior, that's fine. How I explain them the behavior, what goes into the black box, I don't care. I just only predict the outcome. I think there are two issues. One is from your placement point of view, because placement is also important, you know, placement point of view, and even for understanding point of view, because behavioral economics is based entirely on econometrics. So if you even hate behavioral economics, think it has no basis, then you can still have this course for two reasons. One is placements, because every person in the stock market is trying to make money, right? So therefore, so in terms of working, behavioral economics is the guy, if Madras School of Economics teaches a behavioral economics class as a compulsory, I mean, the students will be so happy because there is no theory in this, because everybody hates C of I equal to A plus L into B into G and all those things. They don't like it. So this is like, this is mostly econometrics, which is our favorite subject and the easiest subject that God ever invented. So I like that subject, econometrics. It is so much of data-driven work, and it is all sorts of human biases flowing. So this is also a stimulating course which many people will take. In terms of your job prospects and everything, it is very interesting. But let us go to the more important point of the deeper point is whether it is necessary. Second, you will also be teaching econometrics on this, because these are mostly empirics. So you will get that skill. That skill can be, so even if you hate behavioral economics, but you know what is behavioral economics, then you will develop huge empirical skills. After that, you will analyze behavioral economics and reject that. Reject it, no problem. But you will know the biases, and you will have the empirical skills to apply in other places. So these are two utilitarian objectives by which behavioral economics should be taught. It is simple as that. And the second question is why it is not being done in NBN and all those things. It is something to do with the first question, because NBN and all these people actually. I have not following, because most of the papers that I've been following NBR are more theoretically oriented papers. But no, nothing prevents. You just wait. But Richard Thaler got the Nobel Prize. So this is one of the most important time to introduce. I mean, there has been already recognized. So it is only our, but if you look at Yale, Harvard and all those things, they're having behavioral economics. It is only we are not having behavioral economics. IGEDA doesn't have, MSc doesn't have. Introduce. I'll be happy to come and give one lecture on that. I mean, by all means, introduce courses on behavior. It should be a compulsory course. No, may not be in the first semester, because you are not equipped to take that question. You are not equipped to take that question. It could be a compulsory course in the third semester, because then you must have understood micro, macro, efficient markets, and done some basic finance courses. You have done econometrics. So this course cannot be given in the first semester as a just a course. You have to give it in the third semester first course. And well, you don't want to give it as a first course. You give it as two courses, two sequences, because one sequence may not be enough. And let the market decide. No, you shall, the moment you give this course, you will say everybody will declare this as a core course. You will see 45 people coming onto the course, and the instructor will say, after 25, I am not going to take any more people. Go away. It is only you introduce in the third semester. I'll be happy to come. I might introduce in IGEDA, because core course introduction is very easy. Only the faculty has to say, I want to introduce, and maybe the management with your academic council has to only approve. And I mean, that's very easy to get it, because you are not making atom bombs. You are giving a course, so that will be done immediately.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Prasanna Bharani, sir. Will there be any change in the behavior of people, especially investors, due to this COVID?
Oh, yeah. I think what happens is, it is in that sense not a deep change in the behavior. Deep change in the behavior means it's not the rationality is getting disturbed or something like that. What will happen is the weights on your utility function will change. Earlier, I used to go to a restaurant and have food. Your utility from the food will not change, but your valuation will change. You will say, I want to give less weightage on this probability. So your rationality is not changing. The weights that you are giving on these actions are changing, because your rationality is in between your head. Because we have already taken some decision in our household saying that, whenever some festival comes, we are not going to buy clothes and whatever it is. I'm just telling my personal thing, but it is an important thing to tell. It is not that we are not valuing clothes anymore. I mean, I love to wear shirts, but I think that this is not the right time for me to wear shirts. I mean, so my utility or evaluation of that function of my good shirt is not changing. What is changing is the weight that I put on it. My probability is now less. So I don't think investors were going to do it. Yeah. They will trade less, because they do not know. They don't want to take any risk now. Nowadays, no people will take risk, because it will be volatile. So their internal behavior is not changing, but their observed behavior is going to change in the sort of, they will not take actions which are risky, because their wealth is very less now. So they are not going to take more risks. So I expect stock markets and all those things to be a little bit less compared to, but you never know. Investors behave crazy. They think that, I have lost 100 rupees. Now I should make up 200 rupees. So let me go and jump into the stock market. They should not jump. But this is exactly what is happening. All the mutual funds are actually increasing. Mutual funds are increasing. Of course, most of the mutual funds increasing is coming from SIP, Systematic Investment Plan. Because these guys are calling you and telling you, don't stop your SIP, don't stop your SIP. They're telling and calling you, which may be a correct thing because now you are buying the stock at a lower price. But you should not get more exposure unless you want to make a lot of money. So I have not stopped my SIP, but I got 100 calls saying, sir, right time to buy Reliance and all those things of this because they are now at like selling at 120% discount. Please buy. I said, no, I'm not buying. I'm old man. I'm going to retire. I'm not going to do anything more.
Thank you so much for enlightening presentation and your patiently answering the questions. Thank you so much, sir. And now I would call upon Subhashree ma'am to place to give the feedback and Suresh Kumar sir to place vote of thanks. Subhashree ma'am.
Professor Subhadra, it was a fantastic session. You have really given an broad overview about, I should say that it's a financial disciplining also. Kind of, overview on economical disciplining, how you need to really look in that aspect. I think behavioral economics is one of the area which has not been much explored in India, especially with the, as you rightly said, with psychologists and social psychologists, they are not really looking from the perspective of how important to be an interdisciplinary. Please go ahead, sir.
I want to say one thing. You know why behavioral economics actually is not flourished in any other country other than the developed country like the US and the US and in the Nordic countries. Nordic countries means Netherlands and in Australia and all that. Why this happened? Because behavioral economics really needs a lot of data because you cannot draw samples or trade millions of observations. So when I was visiting the Center for Analytical Finance in ISB, in Hyderabad, then we wanted to do a study on trading behavior. So NSE released us data for 6 months. 6 months trading behavior for every person who has traded anything. That means every trade for 6 months done in NSE in any script was given to us. It took us 2 terabytes of data. It took us 2 terabytes of data and we could not store it. We had to buy one hard drive or 3 terabytes to put that data. We cannot process it here. We used to put it in the, we just put into the Harvard website in the night and they used to run the whole thing in the night there and then they used to give us the output in the morning. And then I find one coefficient is instead of positive, it is negative. Then I used to again load it, only sleep for 2 days and they come back and they'll give the result. So there are two issues here. One is the data set has to be billion. Yes. Nobody gives the data. Now that is why I said, now the SEBI has this policy, please check. This should lead to, at least you should try to write there, right? Unmute, please. Please unmute. Please mute. So you should write to SEBI to say, I need trading behavior data because it requires millions of data. Once you get the data, then you must find out the software. But now, earlier at that time, AIML was not picked up that much. Now AIML has picked up, so there are thousands of programs which can handle all this. They are doing Lasso, they are doing random forest and all this type of stuff, which requires huge data but can be done in simplified programs. So I do not think the program is anymore, it is a problem. Storing data is also not a problem because you simply buy data, you put the data into iCloud. You put it in clouds and you do it. So physical is no longer an issue. Computing power is no longer an issue, which was an issue when I was visiting in 2010. Like 10 years have passed. So computing power is no longer an issue. Storing is not an issue. What is an issue is the data.
Data, yes.
Just write to SEBI. I'm in the committee. I'm not the owner of that thing. We are only in the committee to help the research. So we can always say, I need trading behavior. We have released the data on trading behavior. I'm telling you, we have released the data on trading behavior. Who asked for us? I cannot tell you the name of the person because that's the confidential communication. But we have released the data.
So thank you so much. Again, the feedback is all about the disciplining is right from you. You really pointed out about the data also. I think a lot of researchers has come forward to do interdisciplinary research. I think a lot of IITs are doing that, but other colleges or other academias are not actually much into this interdisciplinary aspects. And this is a very essential part of our because all these are interconnected. We know it is complementing to each other. Yes. Without a person at home having a financial discipline, they cannot be happy also. So we need to really look in this aspect as a very important one. And you have really given a bird eye view on how it is important all of us to really look into. And I really like your sense of humor here and there. You made us laugh, actually. I wish you were my professor.
I'm going to make you laugh by taking another picture. So don't go away.
So nice.
Because now Sumedha is covering her face in shame. That Baba.
Shy. She's shy. Yeah.
Yeah, but who cares? I don't care. I mean, I have my individual preference. I have taken
the photo. You're so sweet as a father too. Sumedha, thank you so much.
I say Sumedha, I see Krishna, I see Ekta, then I see Sangeeta, then I see you, Veena, because now I have seen you for a long time. So now I see Sri, then I see Jishnu. Jishnu Sarkar,
yeah.
I can see
we got
my wife
to
also
know from the surnames.
Yeah, Jishnu Sarkar, Jayati Sarkar, all Sarkars here. Sumedha Sarkar, Ekta Selarka starts with S. Sangeeta all starts with S. Krishna unfortunately doesn't start with S.
But I'm Subhashri, okay. S also.
Yeah, you start with S. So,
Suresh Kumar, yes.
So, yeah, all the S's is the rock.
So, thank you so much.
I'm S. Krishnan.
Yes, Krishnan. Yeah.
Yeah, you come after, you come before us. I mean, you are like IJK. I mean, you are
thank you so much, Professor. It was really happy your session, I should say.
Okay, it's a pleasure to be here. Okay, thank you very much. Okay.
Yeah.
It's our duty to place our sincere vote of thanks. So, Suresh Kumar, sir, can you
please? Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you, Veena, for giving the opportunity. It's my pleasure and happy to propose a water tank today. Okay. And I think it is a session, really a mental health webinar. It makes me stress-free after 1.5 hours. I thoroughly enjoyed your session, sir. For that, I record my sincere thanks to Mr. Krishnan. Because of him only, we are able to get an amazing talk from you. He's one of the core team members. For that, I would like to thank him. And I thank you personally for that humorous sense. And then the point to doctor, wherever the questions asked by the participants, you given that on the point. For that, it is an amazing term. And even in the beginning, I had a difficulty in understanding some of the terms which were told. And then in the later stage, you given that research finding, that I can able to connect with that. And then how this is very difficult for the psychologist to connect, because we need a lot of data. That also you have pointed out. Thank you so much for your valuable inputs on that behavior psychology, sir. And I thank my core team members, Dr. Subhashri and Dr. Veena, Mr. Krishnan, Ekta, Ms. Bharati, and Dr. Chandra, Denu, Mr. Ilayaraja. So they were the core team members, Ananya and Akshay Lakshmi. They helped me a lot to conduct this webinar session. I record my sincere thanks to them also. And I thank that associating organizations such as International Association of Psycho-Oncology, Indian Association of Mental Health and Wellbeing, and International Association of Clinical Psychology and Psychotherapy for the support, and Association Department, MSSW Department of Psychology for the support. Thank you all for your amazing support. I record my final and important thanks to the participants. Without you, our program is nothing. Thank you all. Thank you so much, sir.
You have not thanked the Psychology Department at American College.
I told.
Is it, huh?
I informed. Okay. So I have seen from that past percentage in the beginning slide itself, he's given that priority, the highlight given that. It is organized by Department of Psychology America.
Yeah.
It's a lively session. Thank you. I enjoyed it also. Thank you, sir.
Participants, kindly send your feedback and queries to mywebinarfeedback@gmail.com. We'll meet with another session tomorrow. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you, Shubhrata. Okay. Thank you very much. Bye.
Okay, bye, Ekta. Bye, everybody. I loved it. This is like a class. This is like a class. I can see everybody. I'm very happy.
Bye, sir. Yeah.
Active students for you.
Yeah. I'm everybody is student. I'm also a student. And learning never ends, you know. So you are student all your life.
Yeah, in 4 days, we are completing a century, sir. So
I'd be delighted to be present on that 100, when Sevak is going to score 100.
You are welcome, sir.
Welcome, sir.
Krishna, your presence will be precious for us.
Send me WhatsApp. I will not get you. Send me WhatsApp.
Yes, sir.
And you should make it different. Please don't call it webinar series 100. You say century webinar. Say something like that. I mean, do not call it 100.
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. Thank you.
Okay, bye now. Bye.
Now you are a happy coach rather than an economist, I think.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what else to be doing? You start inside home, you have to be happy only.
Yes.
Okay, bye. I have to go now.
Bye-bye.